Small note to make. I'm only biased towards an actual argument. So, like, yesterday, there wasn't any back and forth. I would have loved some back and forth. Today, there was back and forth. I got excited. You might see it on the footage. It's not bias. I just want an actual trial. Anyway, enjoy.
Yo, Marco was my boy.
Polo wrote Kublai Khan while he was in China.
Alright, go ahead.
So read it out loud.
Kublai, please permit me to leave this place. I need to see my family. I need to see my family from my villages, and I need to return to the place from where I came. You said that you forbade me from leaving, but I am not a savage. I am not a slave. I am not your servant, and I will not stay in this palace place, but my life is waiting for me in my homeland. It is wrong that you are not allowing me back to my home, keeping me away from the palace that I belong. I am begging you, Marco Polo.
So do you think that is a good relationship, that he wouldn't let you leave China?
But he eventually did let me leave.
How do you make sure your information about the Mongol Empire is accurate?
I interview people that have experience with the Mongols and were, like, firsthand experiencing the invasions of the Mongols and conquering.
What inspired you to write so many books about them?
I wanted to appreciate their greatness and how great they were as rulers and conquerors.
Would you call Genghis Khan's invasion an act of divine grace?
Because everything he did was very precise and great.
No further questions.
So you say that the Mongols make great strides in history and other scholarly areas, correct?
Yes.
Were you aware of the amazing scientific advances made by Baghdad?
No.
Were you aware of its destruction along with other cities with immense amounts of information such as the Library of Wisdom?
Yes.
So were the small advances made by the Mongols really worth it?
Yes.
How?
Because they were.
Expand a little.
So you say that everything he did was great. Would you say that him murdering millions of people and destroying hundreds of cities?
No comment.
Okay, thank you. So you said that you got your information from people who had experience, so secondhand, which means you weren't actually there, correct?
Yes.
How can your information be truly reliable if you weren't there yourself, especially under the threat of the Mongols who have been known to be violent in the past?
Can you repeat your question?
So how can you know if it's true if the people who are reporting to you could be threatened by the Mongols?
I have to go off what I got from the interview.
Okay, so you have no first-hand information?
No question.
Yes. The court of world is fabulous.
Why does anyone else have to do that?
Because you're most important.
You're the star witness.
Okay.
But all right, Genghis Khan, let's begin. Order. Would you say this experience shaped the way and your view on how unfortunate people?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, why?
Well, because it made me put me in a position where I could imagine myself in the shoes of other people who were suffering, and it also made me seek redemption for those that had wronged me or those that wronged other people.
What would you say your greatest accomplishment and what effect did it have on the people of your empire?
My greatest accomplishment was uniting the Mongol people and expanding the knowledge of the Mongol people throughout the world.
What is your outlook on slavery and women?
My outlook on slavery is that it is wrong and that women should be treated as equals to men.
Would you say the reason that most of your women were kidnapped is why you made your law?
Yes.
Okay, and how would you describe your tolerance towards those that you conquered?
I was very tolerant to those that surrendered willingly and gave them rights as Mongolian citizens and did not take them as slaves. However, those that did not submit unto me were destroyed.
Okay. Why did you rebuild mosques and temples?
We rebuilt them because we thought that people need to have a place of worship, and because our empire was so vast, unique, and diverse, people need to sort of boil, melt together, and be able to tolerate each other. One of the ways to get to that is by giving them places of worship.
Would you say that the people you conquered posed any threats?
Yes, some of them did when they tried to.
Like, which ones?
One example would be the Shia, who abandoned us during the battle and tried to gain independence by aligning themselves with the Jinn.
Right.
Would you just name a few more opportunities that you gave your people who assimilated to your rule?
Well, for example, we would give them opportunities to seek office. In many cases, China Haba was not one of those cases. We would give them, for example, in Persia, we gave Persians the ability to administer their own government, so they were effectively very independent from Mongol rule. However, they were still under a general rule, almost like a federal government.
Okay, so you'd say overall you helped the people that you conquered?
Yes.
So can you say again how many people that you and your empire murdered?
40 million.
Okay. And you were aware of the millions of women that were raped and pillaged under your empire?
Yes.
From you and your soldiers?
Yes.
And you think that that, as you said before, made them serving to you by killing them and raping them?
Well, if they were to go against our rule, what were we supposed to do? Allow them to be independent? Allow the Arab rebellion to spread through our empire? To allow our empire to collapse?
So I think we've answered the question that he understands that bad things were done to people and it was to prevent rebellion. I have a different form of a question.
Well, okay, yeah. This kind of adds on to this. Can I ask it really quick? So you think by raping the woman that prevents them from rebelling?
Raping the women was a way of almost as loot. When a soldier would loot a building, it was part of something that happened in everyday civilization at the time.
That's after rebellion.
This was after the rebellion.
Okay, so you say that you allowed this surrender. If you surrender, you can fall under our empire, right?
Yes.
So some people, at first, they started to fight because they wanted to keep their values, and then after that, they surrendered. Because they realized that they couldn't fight you. Do you think that it's okay that you still continue to slaughter and destroy cities after they surrender?
In some cases, we did slaughter and continue to destroy the cities because it was already a full heat of battle. In other cases, we showed mercy. For example, the Russians, they offered us peace after years of warfare. We still killed the princes, however, but the Russians received peace following their surrender.
Okay, so you think that the surrender, even if they surrender later, it's okay to keep killing them occasionally?
Well, it depends. If it's in the full heat of battle and they decide to surrender, well, then they've already made their choice to fight us.
Okay. So are you aware of the cultural and the amount of information that was in various places you conquered, like in the Islamic Empire, and places surrounding the Mediterranean, stuff like that? Do you understand that?
That was lost? Is that what you mean?
No, that they had before your
conquest. Yes, I'm aware.
So you think that, so you're saying that the economic advances made by you overshadowed the informational and scientific advances made by them?
What about the scientific and cultural advances made in China? There were plenty of those that came from China, and one example, I can really only think of a couple examples when information was lost. For example, in the burning of Baghdad, the library was burned, and that was something that we did not order directly. Again, as we already went over, it was a separate general.
Yes.
And how about all the information that was made in China? For example, there were compasses that were made in China that spread west, but there was gunpowder, again, there were different types of medicines, there were ideas such as Confucianism and Taoism that spread west. It wasn't just economic, it was also cultural and scientific. Yes?
All right, one more question, and then we gotta wrap it up.
Okay.
Choose your last question, why?
You think, so the justification for your destroying of cities like, you destroyed places in Egypt, Kiev, you destroyed Damascus, as we have already discussed, Baghdad, but not under your rule. So you think that the innovations made in China justify the destruction of culture and society in those places?
It wasn't always destroyed. Much of it was often preserved. As I said again, the artisans, the priests, the scholars, they were sent back through the empire and they were dispersed throughout it, allowing more cultural exchange throughout the empire.
But
okay, that's it. Thank you, Ging.
How many people that you and your empire murdered?
40 million.
Okay. And you were aware of the millions of women that were raped and pillaged under your empire?
Yes.
From you and your soldiers?
Yes.
and you think that that, as you said before, made them serving to you by killing them and raping them?
Well, if they were to go against our rule, what were we supposed to do? Allow them to be independent, allow the Arab rebellion to spread through our empire, to allow our empire to collapse?
So I think we've answered the question that he understands that bad things were done to people and it was to prevent rebellion. I have a different form of a question.
Well, okay, this kind of adds on to this, can I ask it really quick? So you think by raping the woman that prevents them from rebelling?
Raping the women was a way of almost as loot. When a soldier would loot a building, it was part of something that happened in everyday civilization at the time.
That's after rebellion.
This was after the rebellion.
Juror, what do you think of the use of the words like unquestionable, narcissistic, and culture destroying by the prosecution?
They're part of the English dictionary.